Everybody, we've got a short 30 minutes here, so we'll try and make the best use of it. And the book is called The Indian Conservative, written by Jayatirth Rao. And in his own words, it's a meandering, discursive, conversational style that he's adopted. So we'll try and keep this conversation also on the similar lines.
Thank you.
And we'll keep kind of bouncing from topic to topic. And so let me just start off, Jerry, by asking you, you know, why this book and why now?
Interesting. About a year and a half ago, I was talking to Rudrangshu Mukherjee, the chancellor of Ashoka University. And I said, Rudrangshu, the problem with you guys is that all your professors are leftists. So all your students only get the wrong point of view. It's important that someone like me come and give them a corrective. Can I come and give a set of lectures? And he said, of course, that's a great idea. So that's how this book started, as a series of lectures to be given in a university setting. And then Rudrangshu himself, to his credit, introduced me to Jagannath, to Chikki Sarkar, and called her and told her, this set of lectures can become a great book, so please go with it. And that's how it started.
Okay. So it's got, prompted by some reference to the leftist academia that, we'll get to that in a moment. The subtext of the book refers to a history of Indian right-wing thought. Now, right-wing, left-wing, conservative, progressive, these are all labels that have largely been imported. How would you characterize it in the context of India, and what does it actually mean?
Good question, because I think these words have evolved only over the last 200 years. So relatively, in the sense of history of ideas, these are very recent words. And to this day, there's a lot of overlap between conservative and liberal, for instance. In the Indian context, I'm making two fundamental arguments in my book. The first is that there is an Indic, our own indigenous tradition of conservative thinking, which goes back to remote antiquity. And I'm talking about two foundational texts of our country, the Shanti Parva of the Mahabharata and the Tirukkural of Tiruvalluvar. I call these two foundational texts advisedly, because I believe they set the tone for what is a conservative Weltanschauung in the personal, the social, the political sphere. Great ideas, for instance, what is called as Aram, which is in Rajadharma in Shanti Parva. These ideas go back in history. So we have that native, indigenous, and very antique tradition. The Apastama Sutra of the Yajurveda, which even predates the Mahabharata, talks about something called Yuga Dharma. Kane has written extensively about that. Yuga Dharma is an extraordinarily important concept, which again is part of the Indian political philosophy tradition. So this idea that Indian thinkers were all only interested in personal salvation and asceticism and ran off to the Himalayan caves is wrong. Indian philosophical thinkers were interested in social issues, in political issues, and we have our own versions of Locke or Hobbes or whatever, or Burke for that matter.
The second argument
I made is that in politics, in the last 200 years, there are two streams of Indian conservatism. One comes down from Ram Mohan Roy, down to Rajagopalachari and Masani, which is what I refer to broadly as Burkean conservatism. And the second comes down from Bankim all the way down to Deen Dayal, which refer to as Hindu nationalism. So there are two strands of Indian conservatism. In the political sphere, we can talk about aesthetics, social, etc., economics separately. But in the political sphere, there are two strands.
So the two strands that you've identified, you know, the Ram Mohan Roy strand and the Bankim strand, There's also a bunch of other folks like Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar and others, and Karve and others. And so between the two, do you see any dichotomy? Do you see how them coexisting? And do you see them actually causing more polemic than actually resulting in something more...
No, I think there's a fair amount of overlap, both in strategies and in content. Even though he was heavily influenced by the Bible and so on, Ram Mohan finally went back to the Upanishads. Bankim went back to the Mahabharata, and for him, Krishna was the archetypal figure. So you can see that they went back to Indian traditions in different ways. But the strategies that both the schools have adopted, there's one kind of minor difference, I would say, in the early days. The Bankim Hindu Nationalist School was more revivalist, whereas the Ram Mohan School was more, and you mentioned Karve, Ranade, Bhandarkar, they were more in terms of continuity. Both schools, by the way, were supporters of British rule. Ram Mohan told a visiting French aristocrat that he wanted British rule to continue in India for a long time so that Indians could imbibe some of the good things of the Raj. Bankim felt that British rule was providential. Because the British were ruling us, it would actually lead to a Hindu renaissance. So both of them, strangely enough, in different ways. So there are nuanced differences. I'm not saying they're identical, but there's a fair amount of commonality and overlap too.
So when you talk about both of these strands, and essentially you also talk about Ram Mohan essentially pegging many of his ideas to some ideas of the past, especially when it comes to women, remarriage and things of the kind, and especially his anti-sati movement. So is it evolution and continuity? Is it make haste but slowly? And is there any defined set of outcomes? And you mentioned in your book that, look, there is no belief in a utopia, right? And because a belief in utopia leads to a dystopic, outcome.
It's very much, how did Ram Mohan go about it? He wrote in quadruplicate to the Governor General. He had petitions, he had committees, he had discussions. So it was a very evolutionary, slow, constitutional process. It was not a revolutionary, knee-jerk, let's change stuff. And of course, I've argued in the book that he plays what I call the oldest trick in the conservative department, which is, he didn't say that sati was bad or anything. Instead, he just said, hey, it's not there in the older scriptures. You guys have added it on in the newer scriptures. It's a bit of a trick. But that's not unusual for conservatives to do that. But the process is a slow evolutionary one. It's done by legal change. It's done by constitutional change. It's not done by revolutionary hurry and urgency. And the conservatives, as you rightly pointed out, we are deeply suspicious of utopias. In fact, we reject utopias. We do not think a utopian perfection is possible ever. In consequential terms, if you try to work for a utopia, you're going to end up in a dystopia. You're perfectly right about that. But more importantly, in moral terms, religious conservatives would take the view that creating on heaven on earth is God's job. It's not the job of human beings. And non-religious conservatives would take the view that the pursuit of heaven on earth is what Stalin and Pol Pot tried. And you can see the consequences of that. Is that what we want to do?
Okay. And so if it is a slow process, or let's say make haste slowly kind of an approach, where the ends are not quite known, right?
Correct.
But there is a process that needs to be followed. And the process has context. And while everyone talks about rights, and the lowest denominator of rights would be that of a minority right, would be that of an individual.
Mm-hmm.
So minority rights are best protected as individual rights, because that's the lowest unit you can get to. At the same time, there's a sense of obligation, duty, loyalty, etc., to a larger set of entities. And you talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think in the conservative point of view, rights do not exist in isolation in the absence of obligations. Obligations are intertwined with rights. Our ancients talked about five kinds of ranas or debts. Deva rana, we have a debt to the gods. Pitru rana, we have a debt to our ancestors. Acharya rana, we have a debt to our teachers. Bhuta rana, we have a debt to the elements, to the environment, to nature. And lastly, Manushya rana, we do have a debt towards fellow human beings. And the rights come when these debts are met. It's almost like in English common law, there's a contractual right arises when a contract is performed.
Like a social contract in context.
And Valluvar is very concerned about this. For Valluvar, the hero is always the plowman. Only the plowman lives. The rest of us are like camp floor followers. We're just like beggars following him with folded hands. So the idea of the plowman who at the end of the day supplies us with our food is very intrinsic to this idea of obligation and right going together. Now, you talked about the important thing of the individual. The individual is the focus, ultimately dharma, which is called aram in Tamil, is performed by the individual. So it is the individual's challenge, how he or she lives. And that's why conservatives tend to be very, very skeptical about group rights. Whenever you talk about rights of African Americans or rights of gays and so on, there's always a little bit of hesitation saying, are you trumping the individual dharma issue and the obligation right intertwined issue by this shrill cacophony of grievance mongering and demanding of rights?
So when you talk of rights, there's also sort of allied issues of, let's say, the Matsya Nyaya that you talk of in your book, right?
Yeah.
The big fish eating the small fish. So what is the kind of protection and the environmental, let's say, pulls and pushes that ensures that dharma actually gets executed?
See, the Raja Dharma, which is the duty of a king, generally political philosophers have argued that before the Magna Carta, there were no restrictions on kings. Kings could pretty much do anything, and therefore Magna Carta is an important seminal document. I would argue that Raja Dharma has been argued in, has been posited in the Shanti Parva itself. And the one of the primary duties of the king is to ensure that Matsya Nyaya doesn't prevail. That the big fish cannot eat the small fish. Because that is that state of affairs for human beings is something that our ancients viewed with absolute horror. Whenever they write about Matsya Nyaya, it's almost as if the hair is standing up and they're shaking. They are so upset about the very thought of Matsya Nyaya. So the social contract requires mutual respect of rights and obligations, and it requires, above all, justice in a manner which does not involve the weak being at the mercy of the strong.
So you've got this idea of, let's say, a series of different kinds of dharmas that are executed in context, which is a very important
yoga dharma.
To have.
Yoga dharma. Each age, each epoch has its own contextual dharma.
And therefore, one needs to evolve, keeping in mind that context,
absolutely,
as well as the circumstances of that specific case. Now, we've all heard about this idea of India, which has a particular connotation and set of definitions and attributes. Is there an idea of India that is Bharat? As in, because that's what Article 1 of the Constitution says. And the idea of Bharat, meaning that which is beyond just the geographical idea of the state.
Yeah, in my whole section on culture, which is, in fact, I think almost as long as the political section, I have dealt with this issue fairly head on. The idea that this is purely a territorial state with boundaries and a written constitution given to us on one day in January 1950, in my opinion, is both absurd and stupid. It is not true. The idea of India is a very ancient one. It's a very persistent one. The land that stretches from the bridge on the sea to the abode of snow as Bharatavarsha is not newly imagined in the way American academics would like us to believe. It's been imagined in ancient times. And it is very much the land of pilgrims, and very much a sacred land. The great Bengali historian Radhakumud Mukherjee talks about India being a land of pilgrims, which is the same idea that the American anthropologist Diana Eck talks about. So this idea of India is a persistent one, and it's not sectarian. The point I make there is that there is a Jain pilgrimage circuit from Shravanabelagola all the way to Jharkhand, to Mount Abu, to Palitana. There is a Sufi pilgrimage circuit from Delhi through Ajmer, Ahmedabad, Bombay, through Gulbarga, all the way down south to Nagaur, Kadapa, back to Bihar Sharif and to Fatehpur Sikri. So the idea of India being a sacred land merely by calling it Hind and not calling it Bharatavarsha doesn't work. It is a sacred land. And our legitimacy of this idea of India is as valid as when the Jews say that the promised land is from Dan in the north to Beersheba in the south. It is as valid when Shakespeare talks about the sceptred isle, or Blake talks about England's green and pleasant land. It is very much a living, continuous, and very ancient idea. It's not a newly minted gift from some, secular constitution writers. In fact, they were very much aware of this idea. When they say, we the people, that's how they open.
Yeah.
Remember, partition had just happened.
Yeah.
The integration of the princely states was not even complete when the preamble was written. So what do they mean, we the people? They mean the people who share this common idea. Not
Bharat.
Yes, absolutely.
And, you know, let me just sort of go back to the point you made about utopia and all of that. You're clearly, let's say, influenced by Roger Scruton. And you know, he's not very kind, let me say, with the idea of treating history and historical elements as these grand forces that are, you know, entirely material in nature, devoid of culture and emotion and all of that. And he's less than kind to his adversaries on the left, who he tends to call as fools, frauds, and firebrands. And, you know, in your book as well, you've said, look, we've had this almost debilitating impact of academia, media, et cetera, having been sort of controlled or penetrated by these ideas and thoughts, which has not been to the best interests of India. Can you explain?
Yeah, you know, I think Scruton makes the excessive use of those adjectives and nouns deliberately in order to make a point that these guys, the postmodernists, Marxists, Freudians, they have acquired an unholy control over the academic world, both in North America and in Europe, and increasingly in India in the last 30, 40 years, particularly in the disciplines of the humanities and the social sciences. So that generation after generation of student is being trained in usage of, calls them fools, firebrands. I call them charlatans. The charlatan vocabulary of Foucault and Derrida and all these people, which actually is harming us. It is actually creating generations of students who have, in my opinion, illegitimate sources of knowledge and get brainwashed into taking positions which are neither constructive nor sensible. And that's one thing we have to fight. Now, is the fight, you fire a I can't call them left liberal because they're not liberal. Let's just call them lefty vice chancellor and substitute him or her with somebody who believes that Rama flew in a plane. That's a self goal. That's not what you want to do. You want to find the right person. Unfortunately, you can't find the right person because for the last 30 years, they have made sure that no conservative has got a PhD. All the PhDs are only Marxists and postmodernists. So this is the challenge that we are dealing with in terms of trying to reform and change the academic and journalistic world, which is dominated by the leftist Weltanschauung.
And so therefore, our entire thinking, the political economy, the thinking in our socio-cultural world, etc., seems to be dominated by this left-of-center view.
Yeah.
And one sees that right from the political realm
New York
to,
Times,
to economics.
BBC, Guardian, even the damned economists these days. I mean, it's just absurd how left-wing they've all become. They have no respect for the wisdom of the swain, which was so important for Burke, for wisdom of common people. And they have no... It's a very elitist and very totalitarian view of the world. That's the way... And they're very powerful. Very powerful, ensconced there. And we need to make sure appropriate. I don't think in an Indian university today there's any reference to Burke. I don't think there's, if I talked about Shanti Parva, I'll be laughed out as being a, you know, fundamentalist, Hindutvic, fascist, etc. They'll just dismiss us. So this problem needs to be addressed head on. It's tough. It's tough because we've conceded this space to them for several decades and it needs a rearguard action, which is what Scruton tries to do in England, and which is what we need to take a look at how we do in India.
And therefore, in that milieu, do you see, let's say, an emergence of the Swatantra Party, right? Which was, I would imagine, you know, the first real concerted effort.
If you read my book, large sections of it are just nothing more than a lament for the death of the Swatantra. Because it was... one brief shining moment. It was a star in our firmament. In fact, the symbol of the party was star, as it turns out. No, I am very pessimistic. I do not think you can revive a Swatantra party today.
And is it because of the entrenched thinking? Is it because of the state of the political economy?
No, I think it's the nature of democratic politics. Democratic politics, I am now increasingly convinced, starts with an identity. You are white, you're black, you're Hispanic, you're high church, you're low church. I'm deliberately using examples from other countries. That defines where you come from. The economics and political philosophy ideologies are add-ons. So, JDS is a Wakaliga party. Akali Dal is a Jat Sikh party. I mean, these are the identities with which the party starts. The economics, what position you have on income tax or on joining free trade zones, those are incidental. So those people like Swatantra Party who thought that by focusing on free market economic ideas, you can build a political movement, I think it's not going to work. So our choice, if you are a Swatantra supporter, which I know you have some correct instincts in that direction, what I would suggest you do is to try to influence the caucus within the BJP, which is more pro-free market and less state.
The Rajni Kothari strategy.
Rajni Kothari strategy. Okay. Influence Manmohan and Amrinder, who seem to be the sensible people within Congress. So influence those people within these parties who are likely Mitra in Trinamool, Amit Mitra, try and influence him so that you can then move them towards a conservative desiderata that we all want. But the idea that you can start and relaunch a Swatantra party, I think you're smoking something funny. It's not possible.
And okay, which means that a B.R. Shenoy will find a zero cachet even today.
Look what happened to him.
Yeah.
He was driven out. The whole Bombay School of Economics was dubbed bad, and the ISI Delhi School simply took over the country. The consequence, of course, have been tragic. We are still the poorest country in Asia. Korea and Indonesia, which were at the same level as us when Mala Nubis and his people won the intellectual battle, have become very wealthy countries, and we remain piss poor. The consequence of adopting the Delhi Calcutta School of Economics as against the Bombay Shenoy School of Economics has been disastrous. But it's worse in a moral sense. And I think that's the point that Rajagopalachari made when he coined the expression permit, license, Raj.
Right.
By making all of us business persons in this country dependent on handouts, dependent on permissions from tyrant sovereign governments and commissars in Yojana Bhavan in Delhi.
The no objection certificate.
Yeah. India is the only country which has this concept called no objection certificate, NOC. Before you build any building, you need 17 NOCs. Before you start any factory, you need 42 NOCs. So why would anyone want to start a factory in India if there are 42 people waiting to object? So this is the problem that we have done. But that's only consequential. Morally, it has kind of our fiber. We are now a nation of corruptors and the corrupted, because that's the only way business can be done. That's the only way we can live, because of this excessive state intrusion into our economic lives.
Now, moving on to the to education and aesthetics, right?
Yes.
And we briefly talked about, you know, if you look around the city, there's really, from an architectural standpoint, urban planning standpoint, there is nothing really that stands out that is reminiscent of any particular school of architecture, just ugly steel and glass buildings. You take education, there's a very quick anecdote I'll sort of narrate and get your views on. You know, the Masters of Statistics paper in Bangalore University 2 years back had a section on the history of mathematics. And it had everything about European history and the contributions from the Arab world. There was zero mention, I'm not joking, zero mention about India's contribution to mathematics, which is, you know, absolutely seminal and shocking to find that the paper on the history of math has nothing to say about it.
Let's first talk about architecture, because as you know, conservatives love the physical, love architecture. Country which has built the kind of buildings we've built, that today we've got this shoddy PWD architecture, I call it, dotting all our ugly cities. And look at our cities. Navi Mumbai, Chandigarh, Gandhinagar, Naya Raipur, all these new cities we have built are just pathetic, soulless, really sad, considering we did build great cities in the past. I mean, Jai Singh built Jaipur. We did build great cities in the past. Madurai was built in the past. And the same thing with private sector. You're in Bangalore. I can't understand the Bangalore IT private sector building Singapore-style glass and steel buildings all the time. They're ugly, they're dysfunctional, they're environmentally unfriendly, they have bad carbon footprint, and yet that's what we are building in IT park after IT park. There's something wrong with us as a people. This is not just a government problem. I think it's a wider problem, which is why when you come to education, I think the real failure we have in education is that we've kind of underinvested in it, both in terms of quantity and quality. This is 2019, still 30% of our people are illiterate. Korea achieved 100% literacy by the 60s. No wonder they're a rich country.
So we focused on higher education, ignored the primary and all that.
And when we focused on higher education, we did build some great IITs, IIMs. I'm not denying that. But we also did not, to your point, we did not kind of create a situation where people would have. And the aspiration of everybody in Bangalore is to get an IT job, get an H visa, go off, get a green card and live there. There's no kind of linkage to our own. Time's up. I think 14 seconds
left. 14 seconds left.
So that's not a lot of
sorry
time.
Sorry to cut you off, Jerry. I've already received three sort of indications that I need to wrap up. So I wanted to thank you very much for this.
Thank you.
And all of those, you know, really want to understand and get a sense of the philosophical underpinnings, please buy the book. It's a fantastic read. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Jerry.